That's the nub of the criticism we get so often by focusing on the geopolitics, geopolitical approaches, etc., that we're taking away from, you know, we're part of the denial team. That's been our greatest difficulty. And I suppose I want to show you through a few stories to help the way that we think about that. Sanjay spoke about states, nation-states, and we still believe that nation-states are critical to framing the daily lives of people. So although we use elements of critical geopolitics, we also use good old-fashioned, you know, real IR, in the sense that we're not just trying to embark upon a discourse analysis. We use elements of a Foucauldian approach, but just elements. We also use, you know, old-fashioned realpolitik, and we have to. But we also look not just at states, but, for example, climate terror within community organisations. For example, Friends of the Earth is one of our case studies. We've just done this big study on Friends of the Earth. Now, in Friends of the Earth, so the issue with Friends of the Earth is at the moment they're running a global campaign against genetic engineering, genetically modified crops. And if you look at the literature, it's very much anti-science, anti-Western science. That's the enemy. At the same time they're running a global campaign on climate change, Western science is the friend. So the point as a political scientist has to be, surely, not whether the science is right or not. I don't know, I'm not a scientist. I'm willing to accept it on the weight of evidence, but that's not the issue for us, is to try and work out why, in this case, do organisations like Friends of the Earth, on this occasion, use science as an enemy, and why, on this occasion, the climate campaign, do they see science as the friend? So the point is, as a social science scientist, not whether the science is right or not, is why, on this occasion, are the scientists being listened to? That's our stand. That's one of our stances. The other story that I want to tell, again from Friends of the Earth, a little anecdote. We're in Nigeria 10 years on from the death of Ken Sarawira. And it was a celebration of the Ogoni 9 world issue, in the Niger Delta. Ken Sarawira and eight others died in their protest against Shell. And now, a campaign started up on the west coast of Ireland. He said, where am I going here? And the local communities had a campaign against Shell. Ken Sarawira's cousin heard about it and decided to get a group of Nigerian people to visit the west coast of Ireland to link in solidarity against the campaign against Shell. Within a month, international climate change activists began to turn up. And the story changed from one of dispossession of land by a large corporation to a story about climate change. What we're saying is there are good and bad things about that. Making that narrative a global narrative or a depoliticised narrative, a transnational narrative. On the one hand, it takes away from the essence of local narratives. As the Ogoni people told us, if you want to call this climate change, you can go and do that when you're back in Europe, but remember that the real story is the dispossession of the land from the people. That's our story. So we never heard of climate change. So what happens when this global narrative, we've got to understand this post-political narrative, which fits uncomfortably well into neo-market equations, uncomfortably well, and also fits in dangerously well with conservative moral positions. What does it do to that localised story, that essential story? So that's the one, and that's the criticism. On the positive side, as Greg said, Sanjay and I and Adela were debating this. Adela's working with us on this book, and we were debating the other day about the conclusion. And that was the one we're wrestling with, Greg. We don't want to end up with saying that there's nothing emancipatory in the story of climate change. There is some good work being done. And I suppose the positive in the story of the Irish campaign becoming transnational, it had a hostile state. It had a hostile company. It was able to, okay, it had to change its story. But it was able to, through solidarity, link in with transnational actors, and they got a win out of it. So it's not all a bad thing. The other one, I suppose I wanted to talk about very briefly, if I can, just one more, Tiziana, is that when I spoke about the question of social scientists, okay, whether the science is right or wrong, that's not our question. We're trying to understand why is this issue? Why are the scientists being listened to here? What interest does it serve? Greg touched upon this. But it's not just a depoliticisation, as Sanjay meant. It's not just about deterritorialisation. It does that. But it repoliticises and it re-territorialises. New maps are drawn. This is Sanjay's point. The new maps are drawn. So as people studying international relations and studying geopolitics, we've got to understand whose maps are these new maps? What purposes are these new maps of global politics being drawn? They're the questions that we ask as social scientists, and it's been so difficult to ask those questions. You know, I work a lot of my time in Europe, in the UK. I couldn't even have this conversation in that room when I first went. All I got was, Tim, why are you travelling back to Australia using a lot of carbon credits? I mean, and then the third time, I let it go the first time, and the third time I said, look, that's no worries at all, it relates to your Bangladeshi example. I found some very poor families in Stoke-on-Trent. They've agreed never to fly again, and I've taken their carbon credits. And all of a sudden they understood the North-South issue here. So the final one that we were looking at when we're talking about Indo-Pacific, the next question, why is it such a powerful story? And Greg touched upon the concept of meta-narrative. One of the reasons why climate change is so powerful is that it links to a huge range of archetypal narratives of mythological proportions across the Indo-Pacific. Obviously, we have the Christian story. The Christian biblical flood rings more than a few bells here. In this vein, global climate change is a cataclysmic event waiting to happen, with humanity to go the way of the wicked, untruthful, and carbon-unfriendly. In this manifestation of the flood story, climate change encapsulates the concept of melting ice caps, rises in sea levels, and the flooding of small islands and coastal areas. God, or Gaia, is punishing us all for bad behaviour. The North has the keys to the Ark. Why don't you just listen to us, you stupid bastards? We've worked out what the truth is. Just follow us. We've got the keys to the Ark. And no doubt, the North, in the North, the chosen peoples are also the chosen peoples to survive the first tsunamis. But climate change is even more compelling than Noah's flood, for it also incorporates the archetypal story of the Great Fire. For the floodwaters will finally recede after the ice caps are long gone, and the Earth's temperature will continue to soar until the ice caps are long gone, and the river systems dry up, destroying all agriculture by stripping the land of its soil. And entire cities will dry up as the heavens can no longer provide the very life source itself, water, and the wicked shall burn in hell, and the day of judgment will come. But of course, the flood myth is far older than the Christian Bible. And Sanjay and I have been looking across the Indo-Pacific, looking at different cultural takes on this mythology, trying to understand why it's such a powerful story, apart from it's the story of the dominant, of dominant power, that's why it's powerful, but it also appeals to underlying cultural archetypes. Obviously, if anyone did Gilgamesh, the old Sumerian myth of Gilgamesh, it predates the Christian Bible for many years, but also looking at Sanjay's father-in-law is a Sanskrit scholar, and we were having a fantastic conversation about the flood myth in Sanskrit scholarship as well. And also, when we're talking about the Indo-Pacific, we have to look at China. Anne Birrell writes of the power of the flood myth within the Chinese societal context. Quote, "The most enduring and widespread of the catastrophe myths worldwide is the flood myth. In classical China, the myth is told in four stories." And I won't go on, but in his fury, the god Von Care butted against the world mountain that held up the sky. Very similar floods. So what we're saying is that these great shared tales, which pop up again and again through the mists of human history, are not just Western scientific stories, but have their roots within, obviously, Western religions, but also seem to appeal to a diversity of religions and cultures across the Indo-Pacific. So they're just some of the sorts of things that we've been toying with this book as social scientists, asking the question, why is this story so powerful? Who is telling it? And for what purposes? And I hope that social scientists continue to ask those questions, regardless of what current orthodoxies are.
Thank you very much.